This was followed by another book in 1972. The idea of being a servant leader, or service and leadership, less enthralled, is best summarized in Robert Greenleaf's Credo. This is my thesis: caring for persons more able and the less able, serving each other, is the rock upon which a good society is built. Whereas, until recently, caring was largely person to person, now most of it is meditated through institutions, often large, complex, powerful, impersonal, not always competent, and sometimes corrupt. If a better society is to be built, one that is more just, more loving, one that provides greater creative opportunity for its people, then the most open course is to raise both the capacity to serve and the very performance as a servant leader of an existing major institution by new regenerative forces operating within. Up until this time, organizational management ideas, theories, business courses were largely structured around the idea of authoritarian leadership, laissez-faire leadership, hands-off style, and top-down leadership structures. Greenleaf made the concept of servant leadership trendy, manageable, and easily attainable. We're going to go through three different iterations of what a person would do to become a servant leader. First off is the idea of a good leader. What makes a good leader? A good leader is someone that serves a team, facilitates team members coming and working together. Two aspects are coming together and working together. A leader, in this respect, provides the structure of how a team or group of people will operate. They facilitate discussion, and they focus on the team members and what each team member needs to do to achieve the overall goal. They offer resources, enhance skills, and encourage team members to challenge themselves and each other. Building off of that is the idea of an effective leader. An effective leader does a bit more than that. They provide the direction, the mission, the scope, the plans, the vision, and the goals of what everyone is set out to do. They foster collaboration by bringing people together through team building, delegation, coaching, a service leadership attitude, and most importantly, they motivate team members. This could be the spirited ambassador that you meet of an organization, the front page of an organization, and when you walk in, the first person you meet, the person that you're overcome by their commitment to whatever it is that they're doing. They've persuaded you that just what they're telling you, that is a servant leader. The next phase or iteration of a leader could be an effective team leader. This is the closest thing we have to a true servant leader. This person encourages participation. They value all creativity within the individual and the group. They like input and suggestions, and they care deeply about everything that is unique to you. There's no division that would divide. They facilitate communication. They clarify when they don't understand something, and they seek additional information to share amongst groups so no one is operating in a silo or independently. They facilitate problem solving. They see problems, they help others identify them, and they bring people together to solve them. They tolerate mistakes. They realize that to err is human, and they recognize that. They help the individual grow. They see what traits and characteristics the individual needs to develop in order to fulfill their next path in becoming their own servant leader or their next role within the organization. They realize that individuals make up the team and nobody can do it alone by themselves. I think most importantly is they don't make decisions in haste. Instead of having people who disagree on something, they never overrule. They seek all input and use the power of persuasion to get people on the same page and move forward. Now, this sounds great, but if you are the victim or the person that has to follow this servant leader, what's in it for you and why should you go along with them? They have all of these great characteristics and traits. There's been some research that's been done into this, and there's organization or group of people where there's fear, there's a toxic environment, people are undermining each other, and there's constant threats. People don't feel safe. To underscore the importance of service leadership, I'd like to tell you briefly about an article that was published last year. It's the first in a series through the Harvard Business Review about the idea of service leadership. There's been a research study that's a longitudinal study over many years, and they interviewed people that work for 195 different organizations around the world. And they get their take on different things of what works well, what doesn't, if there's any universal traits that are, you know, highly regarded within the business community and nonprofits. When they surveyed 195 different organizations, the number one thing people value in whoever their leader is that makes them want to work for a leader is ethics, integrity, and a culture of safety. People want to feel like no matter what, they can always do the right thing and they will not be punished for that. After that trait in the first leader, in the leader that they would like to follow the most, is every other specific thing that I've given you tonight about service leadership. This goes to show that service leadership or servant leader is not just kind of an idea from the 70s that's kind of coming back into style. Mm-hmm. This is something that people truly want to be members and work with these organizations to feel like they belong, to be safe, to have their ideas and unique things about themselves embraced. So this goes to show that the idea of service and leadership does a lot to help the individual flourish and the team work together. I hope that these ideas tonight can be applied in your leadership journey, whatever it may be, from Toastmasters or your organization or even your house.